Moving on to the next session, we have business intelligence for fashion retailer. Data analytics will power the future of fashion. And the session is moderated by Mr. Suresh Madhur, Executive Director, PwC. Can we have a huge round of applause for sir, please?
Thank you.
The co-speakers for the session are Sujayath Ali, CEO and co-founder, Voonik. Can we have a huge round of applause for sir, please? Everyone, a huge round of applause, please.
Hi, Sujayath. Please.
Vivek Prabhakar, founder and director, Chumbak Design. Mr. Vivek Prabhakar. I'll request everyone to kindly settle down for the next session.
Vivek is coming.
I'll request everyone to kindly settle down, please. We're starting with the next session.
Hi, Vivek.
Hello, sir. A very warm welcome. Next, I would like to invite Hetal, Kotak, CEO, Lee Cooper and all. Hetal, Kotak, CEO, Lee Cooper and all. I'll request everyone once again to kindly settle down.
Hi, Hetal.
A very warm welcome, sir. Vijay Chaudhary, Director, XTEP India. Can we have a huge round of applause, please? And Mayank Mohan, Director, Mohanlal Sons. A huge round of applause for sir, please.
Thank you very much. So we have an esteemed panelist, all representing the fashion industry here in India, all our Indian brands, and let us hear from our panelists. The topic, as you guys know, how is AI and BI helping the fashion industry? Good afternoon, everyone, and good afternoon to the panelists. As you know, like the fashion industry is one of the largest industry across the globe, which is close to $3 trillion, yeah, and it changes very fast, right? The overnight, the fashion icons, like what are the models which talk about, and that changes overnight, and then the change is so fast, right? Keeping that as a theme, like in the current scenario, how is AI helping you guys, right? And we have the panelists from both who are into the online and offline businesses and more into the fashion and the sports gear. Do you think, like, let me start with Vivek. I know Chumbak personally, and I'm the customer to the Chumbak brand. So you are doing more on the online, offline, and you have multi-format of the products, like other than the apparel and the... How do you think, like, the artificial intelligence is impacting your business operationally, Vivek?
So I think if you look at it from an operation perspective, we've been trying to figure out more from a supply chain perspective. I think the one of the biggest areas that we've been investing in and where AI and machine learning is helping us is kind of predicting what stock is moving like. What's the stock that's incoming, how much to order, what's the stock that's actually going out to stores, and both from a demand planning and a supply planning kind of thing, that's where AI is kind of working the hardest over there. I think it's still early days, but because a lot of the good parts about AI is that it looks at clean data. And I think one of the things that's happening is that when we're looking at this kind of data and the algorithms are being built in the first time as well, it's looking out for anomalies that a human would not be able to catch and being able to predict. I think what's happened is that we've been able to bring down efficiencies, take up our efficiencies and bring down stock holding for a bunch of about almost 30% of our categories where we experimented with this last year. Mainly by looking at like what kind of stock is currently in the store, in the warehouse, and in you know, on the way to the consumer's hands. So what we did is that we looked at a program that could analyze past data and actually help you predict even for stuff that you don't have currently. So I'll give an example. We sell maybe, say, watches, right? I think what we did is that the data that's fed in is not just from a design perspective, but it's also fed in from color, strap, material, all of that stuff. And I think what surprisingly is that this data is almost like, I think in the first year it was about 70% accurate, and it's gone up to almost an 84-85% accuracy of trying to predict what watches will actually do well once you feed in the system, the thing. Yeah. And it's still early days, but I think it's helped us save a lot of money and of course time.
Thanks. Hetal, your views on this?
Look, the key thing is it is helping us cut the intuition. Our businesses were driven by intuitions and people who had good intuition and God was blessing them, both was working together, and somewhere this is mitigating that part of it. Second thing, there's a lot of AI which is helping us. So we are partnering with a couple of startups and trying to see that startup from a technology solution perspective. Wherein they are mapping the entire activities which are happening on the social media platforms and trying to give us intelligence which can help us create products better, and also other solutions where we are trying to partner with customers to co-create products in some way. These are all at nascent level. For me, it's just exciting to try some of things. I don't think we have seen enough merit or any solution deliverables to an extent what Vivek is speaking about. But we are seeing great potential in that space. So we are trying it out. It's like survival. It's a matter of survival, the way I would put it that way. And hence, it's exciting also.
Okay. Vijay, so you just started, brought in the brand to the Indian market. Like, what do you think about that? Okay. Sorry.
Hi. So the brand is new in India, but we have experience of 8,000 stores worldwide. So one of the things that we are using AI for is product and customer interaction. So we work with a company like a startup back in China, Space Plus Plus. It's a very big startup, and they provide analytics in terms of how customer is touching a product or using a project, what's his emotions like. And there's a lot of, still, like I said, it's early days, but we can learn a lot from customer and product interaction. That what colors customers are writing, you know, what material customers are liking, what product they're touching, and whether they're happy when they're entering the store, what kind of emotions they have in the store. So this is where we are currently working in terms of AI. And at the back end, also, it helps us, predict. Like the most important thing for us as an offline retailer is, inventory, right? And for us, we are rotating inventory every quarter. So every 3 months we have new inventory. So we can't build enough. We have to build just right enough. And that's where I think the AI has a lot of opportunity, optimizing customer product interaction and making sure that we are, putting the right product in the right amount for the right customer.
Question to the Mayank. Mayank, your brand is one of the oldest brands in India, right? And there's a lot of things which is happening on the personalization and the giving a personal experience to the customer. That was an USP for the brand to be in existence for this longer period. But the AI and analytics, is it helping you to improve your business? One, in getting in touch with closer to the customer. What are your thoughts and what are you doing from your brand point of view?
Great question. So we've been tailors and drapers for 138 years, right? So it's in our DNA to personalize. So the challenge is, so what you do with the tech-savvy millennials, how do you provide them with an Amazon-type experience in your offline stores? But that is what they're used to, and that is what they actually want in the offline stores. So the biggest challenge that we are trying to do is to give that level of personalization that you get at a site like Amazon, because they know what you buy, they know what your purchase history is, and then accordingly, they actually recommend products to you. So we are trying to reciprocate that in our stores now. That is where AI comes in. It's still a work in progress, But there are things that we are trying to learn from international retailers. There is a retailer called Farfetch. It's a luxury retailer, and what they've done is they've developed a technology of smart mirrors. So once a customer goes into the trial rooms, the mirrors actually capture. The customer can feed in all the information: what sizes they are looking at, what colors they are looking at, what fit they are looking at while trying the garments. So we are actually trying to explore with our current providers that we work with if we can do something similar here. If we can use that data, capture that data of the customer, and then give them more personalized service at the store level.
Thanks, Mayank. Ali, to you, you being more onto the online, how do you think this personalization you reach to the customers? Primarily, you are more onto the online segment.
Yeah, so at Voonik, we kind of had a slight lead because we started as an online personal styling platform where we used machine learning and AI to kind of recommend clothing and accessories to customers, and then pivoted to become a destination on our own. But earlier, we were working with other fashion providers like Jabong, Myntra, and we were recommending the right product to our users using technology, understanding the customer's body, personality, preferences, budget preferences, style preferences, etc. So, so obviously, so that becomes a core of whatever we are doing. So we use AI. So when we say AI, right, one clarification is all the technologies are, they are not the moat, right? They are available everywhere. In fact, any AI tech you want is available for free or open source. You can use Google, Amazon's, and so all the tech is available for free. Even the smart mirror he talked about, there are technologies available already, right? So the moat is data. So even when we were working with the bigger customers like Myntra, Jabong, why were we able to do stuff which they were not able to do? And obviously, they had a lot more data than us, right? Because from the beginning, we started organizing the data. When we look at a kurti, what is the pattern? What is the collar type? What is the hemline? What is the sleeve length? Everything. Initially, we were having an in-house team of stylists manually entering the data and then use the data to train the machine learning systems. So while even today, horizontal platforms like Amazon and Flipkart have a lot more data per se, but they don't have this kind of structure. So they still would not be able to match up with what focused retailers would be able to do. So I think that's the core, and the tech is always available. There's open source tech. Or even if you're licensing it from other companies, it's very, very cheap. The moat is actually the data.
Okay. So the good point, Ali, you touched upon the clean data. Vivek spoke about the clean data. That's what it is helping to plan the next steps. I don't know how to put it across, one sensitive topic over here. So design is more personalized. There's a lot of human intensity over there. That's how the industry has grown. Like if you see from the Mayank's point of view, they're the old designers, put in their thought process and do it. Technology bringing into the overall scheme of things. Do you see still there is some kind of a uniqueness coming out from a technology, or it is augmented together, or are we missing something? Right, we are talking about too much of technology. AI is there, analytics is coming there. Where is this personal touch? The design and the primarily, if you come to the fashion, it is more of a personal design. A lot of people are involved. Do you think are these resources being equipped with this technology, or are we missing out something because of a technology? Yeah, probably I start with Vivek.
I think it kind of works together in the sense that. They're both design, which is human-led, and tech, which is both a whole bunch of machine learning as well as artificial intelligence. I think they have to work together. Even if you look at it like two different types of it, right? One is from a perspective of ops, which we spoke about from inventory and planning that better and all of that. But if you look at it from a AI perspective and from a consumer side, is artificial intelligence going to start designing tomorrow? Maybe. It's something that people are trying out, all over the place. But I think something what's happening is that it's too early days for us to even think about removing the human element of in any part of it, if it's from the operational side or from the consumer side. I think the human element is kind of the baseline what we do as, you know, from our understanding and intuition, as he said, the understanding color, understanding look and feel, understanding stuff like that, is still very much a human process. Having said that, I think technology is going to help augment it, but not replace it.
Hetal?
There is
just a pass.
We have one more of our esteemed panelists joining us. Can I please invite on stage Mr. Manu Chatlani, founder and managing director of Soch. Can we have a huge round of applause for sir, please?
Sorry, Hetal, please.
So look, eventually it's about the customer falling in. There's a romance of a customer with the brand and romance of the customer with the product. And somewhere that's what is exciting. Till the time it's in the rational space, there is no romance, there's no excitement. And the thrill part, even in relationships, goes off in a long-term relationship. You know, if you go every day with a rose in your hand to your wife will say something is wrong with the guy. So it's about building that excitement, and somewhere it's a combination of the two. There is no other way as of now possible or visible. I can't do too much of future gazing, maybe. But as of now, the intuition is required. But the input which is coming through the technology is really helpful. Now, beyond that, it's also the ability to process information, because fashion is not necessarily arrived based on what is fashion which is getting consumed. Yeah. Fashion is a function of the aesthetics which are happening all around. The packaging, the real estate, the architecture, the multiple lifestyle changes all put together can lead to changes in fashion. So the emergence of athleisure, so it came from some other route into the mainstream. It has got integrated and it's a permanent fixture kind of thing now. It's no longer an extension. It's an integrated component. So those kind of things are happening, and that's where the technology is helping you adapt faster. Whoever is adapting faster and creating a version of their own, that's where they are seeing traction. So currently we were talking before the start of the session, we are seeing something is working and something is not working. Where it's working, people have done their job better. Now, was it only AI or was it human or was it a combo? As of now in India, it's largely a combo. Maybe the tools are getting used, and many a times humans have the tendency to think you are smarter than the computer. So that also has to be overcome over a period of time.
Thanks, Hetal. Let me go across to Manu. So Manu, you are talking about the personalization from a customer point of view. From the brand Soch point of view, like what is the unique things which you are trying to do at this point of time?
I think one of the topics we were discussing was the art versus the science. From my experience, when you have a single store, the art is very, very, very crucial, very important. In fact, it's all important. But as your size, your geography grows, the science becomes more and more important. And probably at our size of business in 43 cities with 130 stores, the science is 70%, the art is 30%. The art will never go out. It's always important whether to buy a purple or pink or to buy a pink or black. That will always be part of the reason for the success or failure. But more and more, the science is becoming a reason for the success or failure of any business, whether it's distribution, whether it's automatic replenishment, pullback of the right merchandise, which item to discount, which item to buy, size ratio, all these things are part of the science. And the data out there is so huge that I think you need artificial intelligence to sort out their data and give you the decisions. It's just not practical, it's not possible for us to manually sift through thousands and thousands of Excel files. That's our learning from the business so far.
Anything, Mayank?
If I can just add, personal touch is very, very important, I believe. That's why you'll see if in a global world, still 85% of retail is still offline. And even in India, it's actually more than 90%. The reason is the customer is looking for that personal touch. So while AI and big data is very important, we're talking about it, a lot of it is still to do with the kind of training that we are providing to the sales staff on the store. So that is very critical on how, if they are getting those kind of service levels, and if they're capturing the data that we want want to be captured. Only then will we be able to use that data. So that is very critical. From the perspective of our company, so we actually really use our store managers a lot in making decisions in our supply chain. So when our designers actually start making the concept, we call all our store managers, they present the concept to them. So our store managers give them inputs on, you know, what they feel, because they're interacting with the customer on a day-to-day basis. And when the final product is there, they actually individually order for each and every store. We are a smaller organization, so it's, you know, easier for us to do that. But that principle, once we started doing that, we actually noticed that our dead stock really reduced. Our stock turnover ratios were much higher, and our sales actually significantly increased.
Okay. Vijay?
So I think the debate that robot was taking over the world is, you know, decades old, and it'll continue to debate on it for the next few decades. But the technology is irreversible. You know, once it starts taking place, it just keeps taking place. It doesn't care about what we care. So in this perspective, what technology has helped us, I think, from our perspective, is profiling the customer. Earlier, the customer profiling was done through, you know, salespeople in the store, you know, and now what, you know, added that Myntra and Jibong, they have data and they're doing it. So now with a lot of face recognition tools, you can do a very good customer profiling. And once customer profiling is done, then there comes the place where how do you serve the customer? Some customers like to be served technologically, and some customers like to be served, you know, through people. So then once you have profiled the customer, there's a huge opportunity that you identify. You don't piss off the customer by saying, oh, I'm going to just give you, you know, a machine-based, you know, solution. No, you know this customer would like to have more personal touch. So once you profile that customer, the data and the technology helps you do that, but then always, you know, the human touch is always very, very important.
Yeah. So you touched upon the point like personalization towards the recommending what is relevant to the customer when walks in and recognizing them. So giving it to the point like the artificial intelligence or the data which is still impacting the business or the growing, like, do you think is really adding value to our businesses at this point of time? Or what is an amount of the growth which you are getting out of this particular personalization from compared to the typical traditional way of getting the business done, right? So we are talking more of personalization, more of recognizing in a customer. Yes, it's important. That's what the expectations from the customers all throughout, okay? Is it really adding up to the overall sales? So what is that percentage? Your thoughts on that, Vivek?
I think, you know, as one is scaling, one looks at clear homogeneity in terms of product, in terms of sale, in terms of at least in terms of consumer. So I think it's, especially from our point of view and our experiences, I think having personalization is something that we kind of stay away from. I think the idea is, as we just said, you know, that the art is like 30% and science is 70% when you're larger. I think the idea is that saying that how do we make sure what's best for me, even from a supply chain perspective, is a red color bottle selling in Bhubaneswar as much as a red color bottle in Delhi or Bangalore or wherever and stuff like that. I think personalization for us is something that we kind of stay away from. What we're looking for is a lot more homogeneity. So for us, technology, I'm looking at technology to bring in a lot more homogeneity, not really personalization.
Hetal?
Look, as of now, the technology is, in terms of application that we have done in our business, the impact on personalization is limited. We are in the process again on piloting some of the concepts. But for me, I don't have anything concrete to share per se as to what will happen with the technology bit coming in. It's only the co-creation bit to an extent, which was not necessarily about personalization, but it is helping me create sharper, which is where we use technology that has helped us a little bit. So that's a lot more exciting, wherein we are getting insights from many consumption habits, and some of that is not necessarily co-creation in terms of interaction with the customer. It's using a tool to map the content which is there on social media and trying to get learnings from that, implement that. And there is real good traction in that. So that's what I would say.
Ali, your thoughts on this, please?
Yeah, I think, so first of all, like, I think there's no single answer, right? It depends upon the type of the company, the vision of the company. and the stage of the company. So even in the previous question, like when we were talking about is AI going to replace human design, it depends again on the company. If a company is using its art and design to create a new trend, then yes, AI can never replace that, because that design is what the customer is romancing the brand for. But if you look at trend following brands who are more focused on bringing those trends very quickly at an affordable price in a fast fashion way, then yes, AI can probably even do a better job. In fact, like in our company, we have like both. We have human designs and we have AI designs, which kind of uses the data from all the online sales and marketplaces in terms of what color sells, what pattern sells, what is trending, and then like mashes up a design and sends it to the manufacturer to get some designs. Finally, still a human might approve it, but we have still seen that being a lot more effective when you are talking about trend following, right? But when you are creating a trend, art is very important. Very similar way, like Vivek said, for his brand, homogeneity is probably better. And he might have probably like a deep inventory for every limited SKUs. Versus like, let's say, we might think about having like thousands of SKUs with very, very shallow inventory, where the reorder time is only like 7 to 10 days. And we can like keep dynamically changing depending upon how the market changes, right? So it I don't think there is a right or wrong answer. It depends upon what the vision of the company is and what their operating strategy is.
Yeah. Manu, your thoughts? You are primarily more onto the woman ethnic wear. How important is the personalization?
Of course, personalization service is very important, but then again, we use data to analyze the performance of each salesman. We have about 1,600 salesmen across 130 stores. It's not humanly possible to monitor this. So I need data to even analyze the performance of each store. And there was some discussion about depth versus width. So when the bigger you go, you can't afford to have a very big width. You have no choice but to go into depth. And the moment you get into depth, again, data becomes more and more important. So like, for example, a simple thing we do. If I go to a manufacturer and I see 30 options, I select 30 options. I see 30 options from there, I want to buy 6 options. So what I would do is I would pick 15 options, put them as experimental pieces in a small quantity in 20 stores, and pick 5 options which do the best, or even 4 options, and buy them in depth. So this is how quickly data tells me to take the right decisions. When my size is small, it gives me the luxury of buying small quantities. And when I make a mistake, my mistakes are not that expensive. But if you're buying 1,500 pieces of a salwar kameez, which the cost price is 3,000, the mistakes are very, very expensive. You can't afford those mistakes.
Mayank?
Yeah, that's a great point, Manu. We actually do exactly the same thing. It's always better to pilot the product, use data to analyze it, and then to go ahead and make future purchases.
Good. The overall, we are doing the panels over here. Both are doing business online and offline. So how is AI helping the overall customer journey from both the formats, both an online and an offline journey? Is it really helping the customers, one is in the recognition point of view, or any way, how is AI helping the customer journey both in online and offline formats?
Like one simple thing which data helps us is we carry between 3,000 to 6,000 pieces in every store depending on the size of the store. And when a lady comes in and tries a garment and she wants it in a bigger or a smaller size and I don't have it in stock, I have the entire data of all the 130 stores plus my warehouse, which is totally about 650,000 pieces. So the chances of her not getting her size and color in the dress which she wants is minimal. And there's a huge, huge customer delight and satisfaction when I source, when I get a piece from Chandigarh and give it to deliver it to a customer in Bangalore, the satisfaction is huge. Again, this can't be done without data. And even our shifting of goods is done by artificial intelligence. My software tells me, just shift this from Chandigarh to Lucknow, Lucknow shop A to Lucknow shop B, zone-wise, city-wise, it sorts out. This item is sold out here, please send it there. We just don't have the time to get into it manually. It's not possible.
That's good. Vivek, to you, what are the typical customer personas like AI is helping you to manage them better, both from an online and offline point of view? Few thought process from you. What are the typical customer personas you are enabling with an AI?
So I think from an online perspective, it's far more easier to create these personas in groups in terms of customers who behave like other customers in their purchase journey. I think what we're, and that's something that everybody does, but I think what the fun stuff is trying to figure out, how do we create these personas on a retail basis?
Yeah.
Because retail isn't something that you're, you know, capturing this kind of customer flow and stuff like that. We're trying out some levels of, artificial intelligence in terms of looking at data that, for example, our security cameras are trying to figure out where consumers are going and trying to figure out hotspots within the stores and look at their journeys and trying to actually... I mean, it's still early days, but if a consumer has picked out one or picked out two, is that consumer going to buy, first thing? Or if the consumer has actually looked at this, typically, what will that consumer buy? So I think placement and merchandising within the store is kind of something that we're looking at from a consumer journey, but still very early days in the, the machine learning is still learning, trying to figure out what kind of actual physical path the consumer is taking within our store. But online, of course, I mean, everybody, I think, on the panel will be doing
it. Yes, Hetal.
Okay. So look, somewhere the plus point for the customer is what was spoken by him here, which is the concept of endless aisles. And how do we bring that to the customer, whereas the customer is not bothered about the concept of endless aisles, but it's the convenience, which is what is important. So how do I make everything transparent in terms of availability for him? He or she need not know that, it is X 100,000 pieces at the back or what is at the back, but at least I'm getting serviced. To add to it, some of the things which are coming out interesting is the ability to become far more larger. One is you don't have availabilities of certain things in store, but you can have it on your online store. So one of our businesses is a plus size clothing. It's a smaller store by the name of All. And in that, we have started extrapolating into categories which are not even there in our store. Because I have an ecosystem of customers who are coming to my online store specifically to select my merchandise. There we feel that we can widen the bouquet of offerings. So for me, it's a plus point for me to understand, what is customer doing. In the process, it's becoming like a sort of a marketplace. Marketplaces are too large these days. But sort of an ecosystem-led, small ecosystem-led marketplace where we are trying to offer something more for the customer.
One last question before we take up the questions from the audience. So what do you see like compared to the Western world? So what are we missing and are we up to the speed to the Western world from using a technology point of view, primarily more on AI and analytics or ML point of view? Manu? So one of my questions to you is, compared to the Western world, right? A lot of the global brands are doing a lot of innovative things using the technology, primarily more on the AI side and ML side, and the lot of data is there. Probably people are using the neurosciences in the, that's one of the points Vivek was talking about, the decision-making capability, whether the customer is going to take a decision or not. Like a lot of technology is being used before the sale actually happens. Where are we from an Indian market point of view?
Oh, I think if you're comparing the Indian retailers with the international retailers, we are far, far ahead than a lot of countries. Like countries like Indonesia, they don't even have POS, they don't have inventories. We're probably in the top 10 countries, I would say. And we're getting faster and faster. The number of service providers, software providers is increasing day by day. And I think we will be up to the best in the world, maybe 1 or 2 years maximum.
Very good. Mayank?
So I feel, you know, the Indian consumer is a bit different as well. I think by and large, most Indian consumers still want the human touch, the personal touch. So as an organization, we are focused more on that. To your point about endless aisle, that is, you know, we had done that a few years back and that has worked very well for us. We have an online presence, but most of, if it is focused on actually getting customers to the store. So we did a survey a few years back, 80% of our customers were actually looking us online before they came offline to make a purchase. Because they still want, because a lot of what we do is customization as well. So they still want to come, look and touch the product, see the fitting of the product, the drapes of the product, and then make a purchase. So we have invested a lot online in trying to get the customer to the store rather than just use it as a pure e-commerce facility. And once they are in the store, have concepts like, endless aisles, and then trying to use data and use AI to actually lead to a better customer experience more than anything else. So I feel, we don't need to necessarily ape what the Western world is doing, but customize it according to the Indian consumer.
Vijay, to you.
If you just look at proxy data for investments coming into risk capital, if you look at risk capital coming into India, into technology is humongous, right? And second only after China. So it tells you that there is the technology is going really up. And if you look at the technology advancement in AI and machine learning, I don't think that, West actually has advantage overall. If you look at the ecosystem, China has a much better ecosystem compared to, say, America in terms of building companies faster, implementing things faster. And a lot of risk capital, almost all of it now coming from China to India, a lot of those technologies are coming to India with a very fast speed as well. So I would say, it's a matter of 6 months or a year gap between technology compared to the leaders around the world. But we are getting there.
Yeah. Your thoughts, Hita?
So look, I guess we are poised. India as a country, the penetration of smartphones has been a big advantage in last 2-3 years itself. Yeah. It has been very, very rapid. And that gives us the right platform to, if there is even a gap with others, happily to cover that gap, because the content is changing big time, and somewhere smartphones will help the content from move from all those typical website-led content to videos and audio files and explanatory. Product can be romanced with somebody speaking over in a voiceover at the background and helping me understand about the product or the proposition. And that's a lot exciting, because it's about, beyond a point, there's nothing. It's not the forum, but there's nothing about online and offline. It has to merge, because these are just means to an end. Customer is getting serviced and customer is getting excited about it, and that's the deliverable. So I think in terms of India as a potential, it's very clearly right there. Technology is available and local ecosystem is exciting, I think, in terms of the kind of small initiatives and startups which are working on that. Many of them, you hold their hands and they may be able to produce wonders, honestly, on the technology field.
Yeah. Vivek?
Yeah, so I think from a perspective of, as the channel, and people are not actually spending a lot of money on this currently. I think in Indian retail, we have far larger, more basic problems that I think as retailers we're facing. Suddenly walk-ins drop. Technology can't help that. All kinds of stuff. I think one of the biggest things is that our own investments in technology need to, I think, outpace the kind of returns that it will get. So kind of invest in technology far earlier than you require it. And I think, because I keep coming back to the thing, right? I think one of the biggest things for us is that to improve throughput per store. And online retailers who are online only retailers, they're looking at this technology is their bread and butter, and that's how they reach out to consumers. But people who are led as more offline retailers, one of the biggest things is that, it's a clear definition of a customer versus a consumer. So this comparison with the West is that we have customers and they have consumers who consume. And I think there's a very key difference there. Once each store does far more number than what it does currently across the chains, I think then that gives us the kind of confidence and honestly budgets to implement a lot more tech within retail. So I think we're capabilities there, but I think we're still a little way behind in terms of actually implementing that kind of tech at large scale.
Ali, to you.
Yeah, I think when it comes to physical retail, I think we are still lagging behind Western countries in multiple areas, right? Obviously, everything affecting the customer experience, starting with like how the salesperson is kind of interacting with the consumer, what kind of personalization we provide, 30-day return, infrastructure such as parking, all of those, right? We are lagging behind. What we have seen in online is because of our mobile penetration and because of our 1.2 billion, like the customer base, we have leapfrogged. Today, I worked at Amazon US for 6+ years. Today, Amazon India experience for a consumer is far better than Amazon US experience. You don't get like next day free shipping in US, right? Without even Prime. So we have leapfrogged, primarily again due to that mobile penetration primarily due to the risk capital coming in and due to the market nature, right? That has not happened on the physical retail side, but I think that will happen on the omnichannel side. I think we have an opportunity. No country has figured out omnichannel yet. US is lagging behind there. As someone mentioned, China is probably the one who is like experimenting a lot and coming up with those omnichannel stores. I think India has an opportunity to leapfrog other countries in omnichannel, again using the same mobile as a device. I think that's very powerful to kind of serve as a bridge between offline and online and help India to leapfrog other countries. And I'm confident that it would happen like how it happened with online. You will see the equivalents of Flipkart, some startups doing that and like becoming the next unicorns.
Thanks. So questions from audience, please, to the panel. Yeah, the mic over there.
Hi. So as we, I'm Prerna. As we speak of artificial intelligence, we all know that it is a marriage between the virtual and the physical world, and it's bridging a gap, and it is highly required to increase the efficiency of the physical, the brick and mortar stores. So an experience that a person gets online is not experienced by the people offline, by the millennials these days. But artificial intelligence currently, where it is in our country and anywhere outside also, requires a lot of investment by the retailer. So how do you address that? I mean, as much as you want to capture the data, analyze it well, and use it to convert it into sales and better experience for the customer, but how would you address the challenge of the investments that come along with it? It's open to the panel, whoever.
Okay.
I think those kind of investments are like hygiene now. Those investments in technology which are actually helping you get, you know, simple things like the right stock in the right store at the right time to ensure that the consumer kind of comes in and buys that particular product. Those levels of technology investments are more or less hygiene. So those budgets, I think, I mean, everybody would agree with me, I think we're spending. I think the question is that in terms of the next level of spend that you want to do in terms of how much more predictive you want to be, how much more reliance on technology in terms of moving out the human element at scale is the question, and what kind of, you know, budgets those are. And I said that will only happen when a retailer sees higher throughput through stores, which enables them to make budgets for extra technology. So I think right now where everybody's doing the basics and some, but to get to the next level, it would honestly have to be higher throughput in stores for us to be able to invest in that level of technology.
Thank you.
Yeah. Any more questions, please? Yeah. So there's a question. From
check. Hi. I was a little late in entering the whole thing, attending the other session. This is just an offline question, nothing to do with omnichannel. I'm a small-time developer from a small village called Nathwara. We're attempting the first retail mall there in a population of 1 lakh. So most of your retail brands are there existing in two-tire and three-tire and metros. I'm a no-tire town. We just wanted to understand, should I extend my this to you? Would you be willing to join hands? What's your take on a place like Nathdwara where the economy is very high, spending power is very high, people travel all the way to Udaipur, 50 kilometers to spend money on your brands? We just wanted to understand whether you have been started looking at, you know, smaller towns.
I'll take this question because yeah, please. I've developed properties in smaller towns.
Great, thank you.
And I think it's just the right mix of, you know, what you have to, of course, identify, you know, what's your catchment like. You know, you do a catchment analysis of what kind of catchment you have, what is the spending power in your catchment. And based on that, you reach out to the brands which bring that value. Of course, maybe, you know, Mark and Spencer is not the right brand for you. But maybe, you know, some brand which can serve that market is the right brand. So in India, there's no dearth of brand. There's brand in every segment operating, you know, from the very lowest bottom of the pyramid that we say to the very top, the luxury brand. So you just have to do the right analysis, find out what is the what value your consumer in that segment is relating. And then you build a property which serves, it just doesn't serve shopping to the customer, but gives an experience. So you have F&B, which is very important in a small property also. You have some sort of entertainment, like, you know, having a game park, game zone, or a mini-plex if it's a multiplex is not possible. So these places where customers can come not just to shop, because everybody's shopping online. Malls, you need to give them experience. They come, they can spend time with the family. If they're happy, they probably shop as well.
Thank you. It is very insightful discussion. Thank you, panelists.
Can we have a huge round of applause for our esteemed panelists, please? Thank you so much for that very interesting session.